Sunday. Every year on this first Sunday after Epiphany, the Universal Christian Church focuses on the beginning of Jesus' ministry by telling the story of his baptism, which is interesting because it is a story that the early church and many Christians today find somewhat difficult. The question that comes to mind is, why did Jesus, who was without sin, need to be baptized? Each of the Gospels recounts the story differently, so we know it was a significant event that would have been told in all of the early Christian communities. But in the recounting of the story, we can also see how they struggled with it and with this question. The earliest Gospel, the Gospel of Mark, doesn't really deal with it at all. Mark just says, in those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John. Immediately, as Jesus came out of the water, he saw the heaven torn open and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. Now, Matthew's Gospel was written some 20 to 30 years after Mark's Gospel, and during that interval, this question really came to the fore, so Matthew tackles it head on. According to him, John the Baptist and Jesus engage in a theological debate about who should baptize whom before John relents and dips Jesus in the Jordan like any other Galilean. On the other hand, the Gospel of John is so defensive about Jesus' purity that it doesn't mention his baptism really at all. You see, according to John, it might give the reader the wrong impression to show Jesus being washed alongside all of us ordinary sinners. So in John's telling of the story, John the Baptist testifies that he saw the Spirit of God come down from heaven and rest upon Jesus like a dove. But he doesn't mention that Jesus happened to be standing in the Jordan River at the time. And then there's Luke, whose account is likewise eccentric. Just before he describes Jesus' baptism in detail, Luke tells us that Herod has put John the Baptist in prison. So there is no mention of the baptizer at all. And that is because the spotlight is not on who did the baptizing or even who was baptized, but on the dove and a voice from heaven which said, "You are my son, the beloved. With you, I am very well pleased." But let's backtrack a little to a day or so before. The people were in expectation, on tiptoe of expectation, as one translation puts it, wondering if John was indeed the Messiah. He was certainly an unusual man. He spoke with authority. He pronounced judgment with authority. And the very fact that he found everything wanting was enough to convince some people that he must be the Messiah. People who came to be baptized by him came very honestly, wanting to hear him. And he turned around and called them a brood of vipers, warning them that if they did not produce good fruit, they would be cut down and thrown into the fire. If he was angry, as it seemed to be people reasoned, he must be from God. But when John heard that, he said, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie even the thong of his sandal. He will baptize you with water and with fire." And the people became even more afraid. The Holy Spirit of God, the fire part, was one thing. Holy Spirit is also known as wind. The wind isn't bad. The wind of God can sweep across your soul with great healing. But fire, well, that fire was something else. Fire was a purifier, and you might be a better person for having gone through it, but make no mistake, it was going to hurt. And there would be ugly scars left. So we can imagine the people's surprise, imagine John's surprise, when who should take his turn for a dip but Jesus? Not an axe-wielding arsonist, but a gentle carpenter whom the Holy Spirit chose for a roost. And many did not believe in him, as many do not believe in him today. find it much easier to believe in an angry, demanding God than we do in a loving one. An angry, demanding God sets the bar high and asks us to jump over it. And we feel awfully good about ourselves when we do. In fact, we feel we have earned the favor of God and we have a bargaining chip with the Almighty. But on the other hand, a loving God sets the bar high and then humps us over it. But there is a catch. God can only help us over it if we recognize that we can't do the task alone and ask for help. And that admission makes us look at ourselves truthfully, and that truth can sometimes hurt a lot. But back to our question. What was Jesus doing there in the first place? What need did Jesus have for a bath like that? John made it clear that his baptism was indeed for sinners. Sinners who came to him to be washed in the waters of repentance and to rise from them and go and sin no more. But Jesus was, according to every witness that we have, a man set apart by his sinlessness. He had nothing to repent of and nothing to be forgiven for. How much more appropriate it would have been if he had just walked up to John and said to him, "Thank you so much for all of your preparation. Now, I will take over from now." But Jesus didn't do that, because Jesus didn't come to take power, but to give it away. So he didn't take over John the Baptist's ministry from him. Instead, he got in with a whole crowd of sorry-looking people, people looking a lot like us, and took his turn in the Jordan like everyone else. And it was after his baptism, according to Luke, while he was praying, that a remarkable thing happened. Heaven opened, the clouds parted, white light poured down, and through it a figure that looked a lot like a bird, but most of all like something straight from the heart of God, settled on Jesus as a voice from other than the earth said, "You are my beloved son. With you I am very well pleased." What words and what affirmation. Still, what had Jesus done at this point that was so pleasing? It was the very beginning of his ministry, and all he had done so far was say yes to it and join humankind in the muddy waters of the Jordan. Yes, he did that. He joined us in the mud, and a voice from heaven declared, "You are my son, my beloved. With you I am very well."